like to say about Noelle and my association with her. Fulham, boy, I think I've known Noelle all my life, really, starting in 19th. Until just recently. And judging what everyone has already stated, I think it's safe to say we all loved Noelle. Noelle and I loved one another. When we were on the road, we shared everything about our lives. And when we were off the road, we led very different, very separate lives. I went home to my farm in Colorado, and Noelle went back to her home at the beach of Santa Monica. And when we were apart, we still talked every day, often hours at a time. We maintained this lifestyle for more than a decade, and then, as Skip indicated, in 2010, she fell and broke her hip, barely a month after the Lois Lane statue dedication. And her world changed drastically, as did mine. Her last years were difficult ones, and she struggled through all the pain and inconveniences associated with old age, but she did so with grace and humility and humor. I was devastated by her passing, though I could see it coming for some time. And when I think about Noelle's life, there are a few things that stay with me. Namely, it's her independence, her humor, and the principles that she used to guide herself through her life. Her independence. Pam Munter once said to me, "To be dependent is to be vulnerable and inevitably disenchanted, if not wounded." I doubt Noelle was ever dependent on anyone or anything ever in her life. She was defiant, strong-willed, purposeful, and goal-driven through much of her life, I believe. The person you saw on the screen, that confident, take-charge personality, that really was who Noelle was. Up until, I'd say about a month before Jack Larson passed away, she was still ordering him around on the telephone like he was still Jimmy Olsen. And her humor came in so many different ways. She had mostly unintentional humor and then what I would call intentional humor. Her unintentional humor. Dairy Queen just down the street. A few years ago, Noelle said she needed ice cream, so I just walked her over to the Dairy Queen. It was during the celebration. And we walked in, we ordered, she got what she needed, and she sat down. And all around us, you could hear people saying, "It's Lois Lane, it's Lois Lane," in little whispers. Suddenly, a lady walked up to Noelle, and she put her hands on her hip, and she said, "Are you Phyllis Coates?" And Noelle looked up startled and she said, "Oh God, I hope not." That was her unintentional humor. But you know, Noelle was somewhat of a prankster. You really had to know the other side of Noelle to do that. Noelle and I did so many book signings, so many autograph shows. I mean, she loved it. I mean, she absolutely loved it. But sometimes she loved pulling a prank on me. And a classic example was a few years ago, 2007, in fact. We were across the street. Where's across the street? At the Metropolis Planet building. Noelle was doing a signing there. It was during the celebration. And we have a wonderful friend in Michigan. His name is Bill Artis. You know Bill? Everybody knows Bill. Well, Bill walked in, he looked around, and then he walked out. Noelle said, "Well, that's interesting." And then 5 minutes later, he walked in again, he looked around, and he walked out. And 5 minutes later, he walked in again, and he just kind of stood there. And Noel turned to me, and loud enough that everybody around us could hear, and she said, "Well, bless his little heart. That poor boy has no idea where he is, does he?" And Noel did that so she could see me laughing, because she knew that when I would start laughing at something like that, I could not stop. Now, I had forgotten about that over the years. She took great relish in it. And the thing is that when she did it, she would deadpan it, act like, "I don't know what's wrong with this guy. I don't know what's going on." But she did it purposely. Someone actually took a video of that, 2007, and I didn't know it. It popped it up on YouTube, and someone sent it to me a couple of months ago, and runs about a minute and 24 seconds. If you could run that, please.
His name is Andy too. Can't you imagine Ricky and Sosa was little and getting really doing Superman things with his dad? Anyway.
Through her life, she didn't know this, they're actually Buddhist principles. They're called the immeasurables. It was love, compassion, sympathetic joy, and what they call equanimity. Love, it's not romantic love. What it was wanting others to be happy. Compassion, it's not about feeling your pain, it's about wanting you to be free from suffering. So many times I saw Noel help other people who were grieving about one thing or another, or physically were unable to do something, and she was there helping them. Sympathetic joy. She was happy for someone else's happiness. It's as simple as that. There were many times that Noelle didn't feel well, and she went to a show anyway. It was only because she was afraid she would disappoint someone if she didn't show up. She said, they were there for me when I needed them. When I was coming up, I wanted to be there for them. And she did it in many ways. I think in some situations it probably hastened her physical disabilities, but she wouldn't have traded it for anything else. She would have still done it. Through her humor, her independence, and her life principles, that was the essence of Noelle. What you simply saw all the years she came here, all the places we saw her, that was really Noelle. Years ago, I asked Noelle how she'd like to go. Anybody over 60 years old, think about, you know, what's the best way to die? It's going to be painless for me and maybe for my family. And she didn't hesitate. She said, I simply like to faint and fall away. And I thought about that, and that's, what a wonderful image that is. Simply faint and fall away. And you know, she did. When Noelle died, she died in her sleep, with no pain and no discomfort. She fainted and she fell away. And later I asked what her final wishes were. And she said she wanted her ashes spread in the ocean near her home in Santa Monica. And when that time came, I made that journey and honored her request. You know, the ancient mariners used to recite certain words when one of their own died at sea, and those words were simply this: may the gods bless you and keep you and see you on your way as I commit you to the sea. And I recited these time-honored words, adding that I loved her and I always would. But the story didn't end there. I turned, watched her ashes float in the ocean and suddenly dip, and watched them carried away by the waves out to the ocean. I walked across the beach where Noelle had played volleyball since the 1930s. It's the place she'd rather be more than any place else until she came here. And then I went from there to a restaurant across the street. Noelle and I often dined there frequently, usually once a week, and it was her favorite place to go for an evening meal. I entered, said hello to Richard, the bartender, and Don, the owner, and found her favorite booth where we used to sit. I ordered the meal I always ordered and sat in the spot where I always sat, keeping Noelle's spot open where she might have sat. I ordered Noelle's favorite drink, a Manhattan, that we all recall. I don't drink myself. I took the Manhattan and I slid it over to the spot where Noelle would have put it. And as I was sitting there, I was lost in thought. The music came on behind me, and the music was exactly like you.
Wow. Unbelievable.
I had been coming there for years and years, and that song was never played before that moment. Wow. Not that I ever heard before. It wasn't a strange or odd moment, but a warm and all-embracing one. It was touching. It felt blissful. The Roman philosopher Cicero said that the life of the departed is a place in the memory of the living. Thank you, Noelle, for all that you gave to all of us and for leaving with us such wonderful memories of you. Thank you.